body focused on security, data protection and privacy. We are anchored within the NASSCOM family, but we work with all critical infrastructure sectors, and banking and insurance being some of the largest corporate members that we engage with. We engage a lot with the security ecosystem, which is on the provider side, whether it's the global corporations, services, and the emerging startups, about 100 of them now. And we work with the CISO and the risk communities across all user organizations in India. I focus on what are the innovations-led transformations that is happening in the BFSI sector, and how it is important to make sure that all the fintech innovations that any financial services institution, whether you're a bank, you're an insurance company, you're a digital payment wallet provider, or a payment bank, the entire ecosystem is growing, or a platform provider, how it's extremely important to intertwine all of that, integrate all of that with the best of breed security practices, and not only just security practices, but also in terms of how do you mitigate the risk and the data protection and privacy principles that need to be adopted. So I'll focus on what is the technology innovations, what is the paradigm shift that we are seeing in the banking sector, and then the security challenges, and also what is the paradigm shift we are seeing in this entire discipline of security, particularly as applicable to the BFSI sector. A lot of insights that I'm sharing are actually based on a study that DSCA conducted for Government of India, Department of Science and Technology, in something called as a foresight study, where we studied five different sectors, including banking, financial services, and some technology disciplines like IoT, cloud, big data, and others, and giving something like a foresight for the country in terms of what are the cybersecurity risks and challenges that we see based on what we are seeing in terms of developments across the world. Some of you all might have seen this particular slide from me or my colleagues. It's a very important context setting slide. Nothing much has changed in the last few months on this. The changing paradigm that we're seeing, I will not really get into all of this. The key points that I want to highlight is how even banking sector institutions are actually opening up the organization. Previously, everything of enterprise IT in a banking sector or a BFSI sector probably used to be on-prem, used to be inside enterprise networks, very well guarded, whereas increasingly we are seeing that the organization is opening up to external interfaces, third-party platforms, some of them enabled on the cloud, some of them on the mobile, some of them on various other platforms, including deployed on public cloud, some of them maybe on third-party data centers. So this is one point that you see, that increasingly opening up of organizations. Another important point that we look at is in terms of harnessing the mobile-first strategy and the convenience of consumers, the rapid speed at which you can offer new products and services, how a host of devices and applications are beginning to integrate with transaction processing systems. That's an extremely key thing because of which the security or data protection or privacy challenges come into play. Another point is the ease of onboarding and the eKYC kind of a concept which the bank want to harness, so that the time to open an account and the verifications and all that process that a bank has to follow gets reduced, and based on which and integration with the national IT platform, which is Aadhaar, because of which biometrics, maybe fingerprints, maybe iris, maybe in the near term facial recognition and other forms of biometrics that people are talking about, voice and others, where biometrics become central to authentication, because of which a plethora of cybersecurity risks that come up and also the privacy risks that come up. Another point is there have been core enterprise systems in the banking sector, and increasingly they are getting integrated with public platforms, public infrastructure for financial services and digital payments, public infrastructure for platforms like cloud, and of course on the other end, mobile and smart devices. So there were a lot of protocols and interfaces based on which these solutions were built, which are now getting deployed and consumed, or offering services which are getting consumed in a completely different environment. So you need to see how those protocols and interfaces built for a certain environment bid for a certain target of services to be consumed by a certain target of customers is now getting opened up beyond the enterprise networks over to the cloud on one end and smart devices on the other. And of course the adoption of digital channels and the entire globalization of banks in terms of the SWIFT networks, the RTGS, the UPI platforms that are now involved. So these are the key attributes based on which the security and the privacy risks come up. Similarly, in terms of a paradigm shift, I think mobile first, offering solutions on the mobile platform, not really getting into all of them, but a few points. The mobile first strategy used to be a good buzzword, cloud first, mobile first, but mobile first is a strategy that is really becoming a reality, not somewhere in the remote future, but is becoming a reality in the near term, even in a relatively well-regulated sector like banking. Similarly, APIs are becoming the way to go, the entire API frameworks. I remember recently I was hearing to the CIO of SBI, who was talking about almost 320, that was about, I think he was speaking on the keynote in the Oracle Open World. He talked about their entire APIs that they're deploying is almost 300 plus. So the API-based infrastructure based on which your systems are getting opened up for third-party solutions, third-party provision. And when you talk about integration with third-party ecosystem, we are not just talking about retail banking. I'm aware of some financial services institutions integrating with third-party partners or platform companies, even for something as core as wealth management services, treasury management services, which probably a few years back everything used to be done in-house, very closely guarded networks. And there's a 360 degree integration that is happening between the front office and back office, not only to empower the employees to be able to engage with their consumers and customers, whether it's in the corporate banking or in the retail banking, but also to be able to empower the consumers to consume the solutions that you have deployed. And increasingly, I talked about integrating of devices, so it's not just smart devices. You're familiar with wearables, whether it's a smart watch which can get integrated with whatever. So there is a completely new league of devices which we have never experimented with in an enterprise infrastructure scenarios, because of which you need to understand what are those protocols that you need to support, what are those interfaces that you need to support. And there's a whole lot of integration that is happening, particularly for EYC with biometrics. And we know, particularly in the banking sector, there's a lot of experimentation that is happening on how can they leverage blockchain. We are beginning to see some startups who are leveraging blockchain for security solutions. While whenever we talk about blockchain, I think the cryptocurrency and virtual currencies occupies the attention. There's a lot more applications and use cases of blockchain in the solutions that you can deploy, particularly when you're integrating with third-party ecosystems, supply chain providers. I know banking sector has taken the lead with this consortium called, excuse me, I have a bad throat, in terms of the banking. And increasing compliance requirements based on which a whole lot of technology solutions from third-party providers, whether it's global platform providers, to startups that are getting deployed, based on which you have to evaluate all the risks that it gets posed when it gets integrated with your banking system. In terms of technology adoption, this is the insights of that foresight study that I was talking about. Broadly, when we see what are the areas in which technology is likely to get infused into the banking technology platforms and the innovations that are happening, which broadly is talked in the area of fintech, whether it's remote process automation, right? The entire cognitive computing and the API frameworks led. Near field communications and biometrics. And biometrics, I think fingerprint and iris is happening in the near term, but increasingly we will look at voice, we will look at facial recognition getting integrated for authentication.
and wearables and IoT. And of course, there are ATM interfaces which probably are going to get mobile integrated. So if you look at the roadmap, based on our study in 2017, we looked at a certain roadmap, but I believe we have taken a very conservative estimate. The technology innovation leapfrogging is happening at a much faster pace than we have anticipated when we started this study. So we are looking at all of them in terms of an early adoption to a very pervasive use where this becomes the default happening in the next 4 to 5 years time frame. So particularly, we are seeing integration of big data analytics not only for core banking and financial services solutions, but integration of AI, machine learning into the security stack that is getting deployed in a bank. That is happening in the near term. While we have anticipated that there will be more broader proliferation of that in year 18, in 2019-20, we are beginning to see a lot of leading banks in India leapfrog that deployment, trying to experiment with some startups and also integrating some of the AI and machine learning solutions. So while this time frame was something that we had anticipated when we started the study, we are beginning to feel this is happening at a much faster pace than what we had anticipated. Wearables and IoT, maybe wearables and IoT, currently we don't see too much of that in India, but globally we are beginning to see how IoT devices are getting integrated seamlessly with financial transactions, where a smart fridge can go ahead and reorder something. Even if you see some of the devices that are beginning to come into at least some urban homes, like the Amazon Echo Alexa device, where that assistant can actually reorder something for you, where probably right now the way it is, the reordering happens is if you have designated a debit card or a credit card or the Amazon wallet as an instrument from which you want to do, there is a seamless integration that is happening. We believe this will be a little more pervasive, maybe not so much in the near term, in the next 1 or 2 years, but when you're thinking of leveraging the innovation, fintech innovations, and plan and anticipate the security risks and start thinking of what your security roadmap from a technology process people perspective is, you need to look at these scenarios and build that roadmap into the platforms that you're deploying. So just like the fintech roadmap in terms of security technologies, machine learning, AI, and the entire machine language stack or solutions, very early when we started in 2016 and 17, but increasingly whenever we talk to a CISO, we talk to a risk professional, the minimum that they're evaluating is how do they learn from the entire data, you know, gigabytes of data that their SOC systems or their SIEM systems are spewing out. How do they build the intelligence to be able to now build the response and detection strategy and remediation strategy? Very early, maybe a year back, but increasingly that is becoming mainstream whenever you have any conversation with a CISO of not just large banks, but also the mid-sized and some of the public sector banks. Particularly in banking sector, things like experimenting with bug bounty programs or experimenting with, you know, blue teaming, red teaming exercises was not happening much. But in the last 12 months, we have seen a lot of banks invest in training and skills development, where people are taking 5 days off doing those workshops where red teaming, blue teaming exercises are happening, participating with third-party providers who are probably running things like cyber ranges. We're beginning to see that at least a few banks, maybe not broadly all financial services institutions, that is happening. Similarly, focus on security reviews of secure coding and in terms of application security reviews, not only of the existing systems, but anything that they deployed. Previously, I think the focus was on rapid deployment, whether it was a mobile app or any other, you know, product and service to be able to empower your employees, particularly in the area of health management and others.
I think the CISOs and the risk teams are beginning to have a bigger voice when they talk to the IT partners or when they talk to their core IT teams and the CIO teams. So there is beginning to be that focus that is coming. And while security ops was always the focus of the banking sector teams, whether in the risk or CISO teams, but I think the entire holistic approach to not only SecOps but DevOps, the provider ecosystem is now beginning to get, you know, a little more mainstreamed on this entire concept of DevOps. I don't mind confessing that I think DevOps as a discipline is still a very nascent discipline in India. It needs to be scaled up so that this concept of security by design and privacy by design is not just a buzzword, but that practice gets integrated into various solutions are developed and deployed. Very early stages, particularly in DevOps security, I think a lot more needs to be done. Even before the user organizations, a lot more needs to be done in the provider organizations, which is building solutions or which is implementing all the services, the arms of those organizations. Multi-factor authentication began on that. We believe multi-factor authentication and the security architecture protocol standards adoptions, best practices adoptions around that is still evolving. The debate every day, there are different debates globally. There is one trend that we are seeing. We are beginning to see certain trends in the Indian ecosystem, and we believe this is an evolving practice. And the security provider ecosystem from the IT industry and the security and risk functions of the banks need to track what is happening globally. And unfortunately, we as a country overall in India, we do not participate too much in that standard developments exercise very early. So we lose out on the opportunity to see globally where those developments are happening, so that when we are looking at a technology stack, a security stack, solutions, mobile apps, we are not clued into those developments and where they're evolving so that we can build our roadmap. But I think there is enough sensitization that is happening in terms of the global standards development itself, but a lot more needs to happen, and it needs to happen from the provider side, and it also needs to happen from the user enterprises side. And the security standards in terms of wallets, the prepaid instruments, or the ATMs, again it is evolving. There's a whole lot of legacy, maybe not so much in wallets and the prepaid instruments, but there's a whole lot of legacy in terms of the ATM networks and the devices. How do you make sure that those protocols and those standards, as you're integrating to external third-party ecosystems, third-party platforms, cloud platforms, how do you upgrade all of them? So we are seeing all of them at different evolutions. Some of them will take longer than what we have anticipated when we have done this study, and some of them might accelerate much faster, maybe in terms of biometric authentication, consumer authentication, in terms of not just fingerprint but probably voice-based authentication. These things, maybe some of them will accelerate faster, some of them will take a little longer than what we have anticipated. So in terms of security technologies, we are seeing a lot of this. Where I think we in India need to do a much better job, and conferences like this hopefully will stir that deliberations, or conferences that some of the tech and industry players also host, where in terms of security architecture, the standards, how do you upgrade or retire some of the legacy solutions that we have in the enterprise as we start integrating with third party. And before I move on to the next slide, something that I cannot not pay enough attention to is, previously in the BFSI sector, you had the internal teams, you had a core platform stack, which was probably, you know, a database vendor, an operating system vendor, and some middleware, and then you had your core turnkey system provider to whom you have outsourced. Whereas now when you see the supply chain, right, who's enabling you to provision this entire enterprise platform and the mobile solutions, it's a complete ecosystem from a very nascent startup to a global cloud player. It's a complete ecosystem which is helping the enterprise provision these platforms and solutions, not only on the IT side, but on the security and the risk side. So how do you make sure that the supply chain security for all the devices that you are deploying
and all the solutions and services. That again is a very nascent discipline. So I think we need more of those third-party audit organizations which are able to do that supply chain. What is the in-house facilities that we have in the country to be able to do that testing and certification of everything that you deploy, whether it's a mobile app from a startup to an enterprise firewall to maybe upgrading your next generation CPS. So supply chain security for end-to-end is something that we, our capability within the country needs to be enhanced, and it needs to be done on both ends, where the user enterprises which are procuring these solutions give enough attention to that, and the provider system also matures to that, otherwise we will continue to have these risks. In terms of financial innovations and impact on security, I just wanted to spend insights on a few of them. One is all the revolution or evolution that is happening in terms of authentication, because of which I think the threat, it could be near field communications, which could be or it could be biometrics, it could be how authentication is happening through smart devices. So the threat surface and that landscape of the risks that you face and the vulnerabilities that you're getting exposed to, we still don't have a 100% hang of that. That we keep discovering those solutions, those problems, and then obviously we will be looking at solutions to be. I don't think anybody in the security profession can say that I have a 100% hang of what is the threat surface like at any moment of time, because it's continuously evolving and surprising even the best security professional in the world and in the country. Similarly, we are looking at a whole lot of advisory services, and you're deploying all of this, whether it is analytics, whether it's AI, machine language based solutions, not just for security, but for your core business services, so that you can provide enhanced customer service. There's a whole lot of automation that is happening so that you empower your field employees to be able to engage in a more rich way with the consumers, whether the consumer may be a corporate or maybe a retail customer. We are beginning to see use cases of blockchain, whether in terms of trade finance, in your treasury kind of solutions. We're beginning to see that. We don't see too many of those use cases, but I do know some of the banks have formed this consortium and some early pilots have happened. And there are also 2-3 startups which are beginning to leverage this technology for cybersecurity solutions. Then this entire risk of integration of IoT devices and integration of wearables, empowered to do automated financial transaction where maybe something is getting ordered or a payment is being made, probably currently more integrated with wallets, but I don't see any reason why it cannot be integrated with your traditional bank account. Because of which, what are the emerging imperatives that we see in terms of cybersecurity is the security of the devices that you deploy, devices, how do you ensure security of the devices which your consumer uses, yeah? The hardware threat interface that you're getting exposed to was probably previously was within your branch infrastructure, very secure logging onto your intranet, whereas it's now pervasive anywhere outside of your enterprise IT. Similarly, security of your end user devices, which is the obligation that it places on the bank and the service providers of the bank on end user awareness, continuous end user awareness, because it's not like we do a security campaign of the consumers in the month of April and then you believe that the rest of the year they were to be aware about that. How do you make sure that we play a responsible role in educating the end users? And most importantly, increasing the discipline of secure coding and the security reviews that need to happen before an app goes live, which I don't think we pay enough attention to. In terms of the financial service sectors, there are a whole lot of actors, and previously probably the main risk that we could see was external and insider, but when we look at the risks that come from external, it could be insiders, it could be service providers. We've had instances where service providers solutions or people have compromised the networks. It could be complete third parties with which you integrate, and of course there is this organized criminals. This is, we have taken a shot at it. I would not say what is very high, moderate is a question of debate, but we have taken a shot at classifying currently, for example, I think when you look at organized criminals, there's a whole lot of risks in critical information infrastructure. We look, at least till recently, it was power grids, it was, you know, oil and gas infrastructure, but of course the financial services platform also has a risk, and increasingly that would be more critical, whereas previously when we looked at critical information infrastructure, what comes to your mind where a breach can cripple the economy of a country was a power grid, right? That was what would come to our mind, whereas increasingly it could be a healthcare infrastructure or a financial services infrastructure. In terms of third party, I think third party could be because it's not just one turnkey service provider, you're working with a cloud operator, you're working with a data center operator, you're working with a turnkey system integrator or a platform provider which is doing your CBS, and then there are third party providers like very nascent startups. So there's a very diverse ecosystem of third parties that are servicing you, and there are risks. And of course, Mr. Ramachandran already talked about it, insider risk has always been very high. I don't want to comment on the current thing, but I think in any breach that we have seen, I think we don't give enough attention to insider risk, and insider risk could be just low capability of the teams which are operating that, because we have not invested in that people capability development. Insider risk could also be just a process gap or the rigor and discipline of enforcing the process and policies that the organization has. So this is a quadrant, and the terminology is the standard terminology we are looking at. In terms of fintech innovation and the projects, if you see any business insider, your digital banking teams, your wealth management teams, or your board level, obviously, the functional managers, their entire focus is on how do I harness the fintech innovations? How do I go to market with a product and solution harnessing this innovation? At the speed at which where I get a heads up from my nearest competitor. Am I right? A business leader is always bothered about how do I harness the innovation to get business advantage. Whereas the cybersecurity, the risk teams of the organization are sometimes seen as roadblocks because they feel that somebody says that if I want to go live with this mobile app, 6 weeks is not enough, I need 12 weeks, to be able to do a very rigorous testing of that and rigorous integration testing of that. But typically, there has always been a clash, but increasingly, I believe, given the kinds of incidents and the risks and the financial loss, reputation loss, challenges that you will face from the regulator, I believe there will be a better synergy between these two so that we do not see some reckless innovators. I don't think in the critical infrastructure sector and in the banking sector there will ever be a scope and opportunity for reckless innovators. And I would believe that the boards and the senior managements will pay enough attention to the risks that a security team is raising, because increasingly I don't think there is any choice. So there are these integrators, there are conservatives, there are reckless innovators. Ideally, we should be where we harness the digital technologies by evaluating a 360 degree view of what the potential risks are and the security practices and solutions that we can deploy to mitigate those risks before we go live. There are some challenges. Security is still broadly a bolt-on exercise. Investments into security take lesser precedence to investments in digital platforms, new technology solutions, upgrading the data center, maybe leveraging the cloud or deploying a new stack. It still is taking, but we have seen a big change in the last 12 to 18 months time frame, where I think at a board level, the attention that is paid to the investments for security is only increasing. And while the culture, the broader culture and the management's thinking, the attention for security is still low, but increasingly it is growing, and I think the regulators are also playing an important role. I will let this discussion happen in the rest of the sessions. So some of the opportunities for collaboration that needs to happen is, how do we look at, these are some of the imperatives for the future. I think some of the mature banks are already looking at all of this. How do we move
from prevention to detection and response, how do we leverage technologies like AI and machine learning for this? Similarly, when you integrate with third party, there is a lot of integrating that is happening with peer-to-peer platforms. It could be how are you integrating with third party wallets with your banking systems, with the public infrastructure like UPI and whatever the NPCI provisions. Of course, SWIFT is another one. How do you, what are the controls that you're placing? And when I say controls, it's not just technology risk controls, but people, process. I think there's a lot more attention that needs to be paid there. And in terms of IoT security, because it's a fact of life that more IoT security, IoT devices will be integrated with financial services and payment systems and automated payment transactions that might be happening. So how do we give that? I don't think we give that enough attention. I think smartphones and mobile systems integration, there is enough more attention in the last 12 months and it will increase. But how do we look at the new devices? Because you know that your smartwatch can be integrated with the internet based on which there's a lot of integration with your mobile app that can happen. How can we pay attention? I think given that the security teams, CISO teams and risk teams are so bogged down by the overall enterprise IT landscape, some of these newer devices and solutions that are potentially getting integrated by metrics, we are not able to pay enough attention because of probably the resource constraint, but those could be the biggest. Because you know in some of the critical infrastructure, something as simple as HVAC created big breaches, right? Whoever expected a HVAC system to breach some enterprise network, right? You never care about what your HVAC vendor is doing. So how do we learn those lessons from critical infrastructure sector into the banking sector with the kind of vulnerabilities that some of the new devices and new solutions can pose? So I will stop here and I'll let my rest of the colleagues, and I'm sure there are other sessions which will get into the changes that we are witnessing in terms of the security paradigm, what are the new solutions, what are CISOs looking at. So I will stop here.